Jimmy, your usher, and today we are back live to teach a misty morning lake. One way or another, today you guys are going to learn how to paint mist at home with your acrylic paint. It is just like my mission. I so appreciate you hanging in to make it your mission, too. My husband has been John.
Thank you.
Great on the YouTubes. If you could share with us a picture that we are painting today, that would be amazing. Amazing. All right, so that's what you guys picked. You have put up, if you go to the Facebook group, which is the Archer official Facebook group, we do polls there. And on those polls, sometimes you guys pick paintings that we're going to do. If you guys show a lot of interest in a subject and you guys give it a lot of engagement and a lot of excitement about something, then I generally will teach it. Initially, this was going to be part of another project, but you guys liked it so much that I decided to teach it and paint it anyways. Because you guys were just really into learning how to paint this. That is our mission today. If you check the description below, there's more information for you about materials, traceables, all of that stuff. And that's always found on our website, thearcherpa.com. And that's just there for you guys all the time, including our whole lesson library and everything you need to know to just be painting and starting your painting journey. I am excited to be doing this.
Yes, too.
Because today's live, and we had some screen problems earlier, and hopefully you guys made it to the retake of this, so you can see it. Don't forget to get those thumbs back up again for the YouTube. Because we had to change screens, so we lost all of it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So let's know for being at least troopers. Trooper zones.
Yeah.
And then, what's
that? I'm not mad.
I think I'm just keyed up now. So, materials. I got an 11 by 14 canvas board here. I've written wishes. I went back to Daniel. We have a wish for Daniel's dad. He's going through some medical stuff. We really want some good doctors to get to him. And we had a wish for Colleen. Family and career to be okay, which is good and right things to happen there. And then, of course, we had the wish of putting cancer in face. We just take cancer. We're not as bad. And so, we are always wishing that in our lifetime we see an end of that illness in humankind globally.
Yeah.
Just God, that no person has to go through that again. So first we have the 11 by 14 canvas, and we're going to have to make, to start our busy mist, we're going to have to make a color gram. So again, materials are down below, but I have some put out on the palette, and we're going to go over here. All right, so I have a little aquamarine blue, Mars black, and some titanium white, and again, I'm going to make a little skin now, because acrylic paint dries in dry conditions. I'm adding a little of my ultramarine blue to my Mars black to kind of cool that black. And when I say cool, I mean like on a color wheel, blue and purple are cool colors, and red and orange and yellow are warm colors. Sort of a deceptive thing, not a factual temperature thing. I'm going to take the white I have left and start mixing this in for toning color. Tone, 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 tone. I suppose you could have put it out for a campaign. I didn't. This gray, this first of ground color, needs to be lighter than you think.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very light color. In fact, it's almost the lightest color on the canvas. And it's really important to get this effect if we start out with this color. So I have that there. I'm going to get my big number 30 brush, and I'm going to paint all of my 11 by 14 canvas. It's just a nice thin coat, not watered down coat, just thin coat, of this tone gray. It is our sky, is our lake reflection, and it's the basis of the misty effect we're going to be seeing. And I'm using this number 30, this big boy, so I can cover this canvas quickly, but you could use any brush you have in your brush. As long as the brush is going to cover the canvas, you're good.
Yeah, and we're super excited to be here. We've already got right back up to 460 people. Everyone's really happy to be here with you painting along today. So I just wanted to let you know everyone's real, real happy and real excited to be here.
I so appreciate our community and the way you guys hang in and you understand about some of these tech issues that we have trying to teach art this way. And I so appreciate all the support I get. Especially that you get some. I hear a lot of people really appreciate all the tech stuff you do because I think we all understand everywhere how hard the tech challenges actually are. All of us around the planet who have any technology totally get what can be challenging and stressful, even though it makes our lives easier, even though it's a nice extension of our human experience. It can also be the source of our aggravation in our home. You know, all these smart electronics sometimes help make us feel so smart. So, I think it's part of the experience. I'm going to rinse this brush out really well. I've got my first tone on here. Now, I'm going to dry canvas because I'm going to want to put in my horizon line and start my distant misty trees.
Mm-hmm.
So let's get that done real quick.
Okay. That's okay. So thank you guys for coming and hanging out with us today. It's just so nice. Oh my God, there's over 480 people here, almost 500 people here hanging out with us today. That's pretty awesome. So I look forward to seeing everybody's Misty Lake boat scene. So I should see 500 beautiful paintings out there on social media to greet us. My favorite thing to do is to see all the paintings that you guys do, which wouldn't believe. Cinnamon and I, she comes in and sees me in the morning as I'll be flipping through different Facebooks and Twitters and websites to see all of that stuff. It's really just a great big pleasure for me. So thank you guys for sharing that stuff with me. I was just telling them how I enjoy looking at all the paintings they send in.
You really do. You love reading the stories and the paintings. He lurks in all of our groups. He lurks in all the Facebook groups. He lurks at the website. We have a live chat that goes on our website so people can talk to each other post-show.
Mm-hmm.
And John wants to see what everybody has to say. I don't mean that in a creepy way. I'm sorry. He's not creepy.
I'm a lurker.
He's a lurker. I have some detail brushes out for some detail work. And I'm just picking out now my titanium white, my burnt, my modest black, and I'm going to put out a little of my ultramarine blue again. The reason I'm putting paint back up is that because of technical issues today, the paint has begun to dry and skin. Acrylic paint dries really fast. And I'm telling you this because as you're out watching things and you're learning things, and you're trying to determine how something is done, especially if you're watching a demo, if you're watching a demo and the paint stays wet and it blends indefinitely, it probably isn't acrylic, it's probably oils. So when you're trying to figure out how to do that landscape, you've got to make adjustments in your mind that you're painting acrylic and your paint is going to dry. Your paint is going to give you hard edges over soft edges easier. So when you're looking at projects, you're looking at things and saying, I want to paint like this, remember that you've got to make adjustments between oil and acrylic. But I'm going to try to show you how to paint more in an oil landscape style with this next series of landscapes so you can figure out how to get those softer edges, like so many of those awesome oil artists do. All right. So I've got the palette back out here again. I'm going to take my palette knife. This is a diamond palette knife. I've got a little ultramarine. And I'm mixing them again. Right? We've got this nice, we want to make our base gray color. See how that really over darkened a bit our white from what we had, and it's quite cool. But the next color, believe it or not, is actually warm. So take this, I'm going to wipe off my eyes, and I'm going to add a little of my brown to some of this. So I've got my original color. And now it's kept this slightly warm, so you can kind of see how this is warm. It'll almost look gray in my palette, and this one's slightly cooler. And then I have my white here. And what I can do is now put in my first layer of trees, which I think I'm going to do with a number 8 cat tongue.
Now, so, I was thinking chapter, so let me ask this a couple questions. So
okay,
I'll
sit by Elderberry Lemonade.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll see your question.
I was reading questions to ask you, so I kind of missed what you were talking about. So, now over here on the whites, are you using zinc white or mixing white here?
This is still the titanium white. I'm not going to the zinc white yet.
Now, zinc white and mixing white are pretty much the same thing, right?
No.
No.
I don't think I put out
the
white. I'm pretty sure I put out
titanium
white.
No, you were just asking about zinc white.
Yeah, so zinc white is here. Yeah. So, whenever you can't tell, here's the thing. Whenever you can't tell which white is zinc and which is titanium, this is the zinc. see the difference on my fingers?
Oh.
So they're not the same ones. It's slightly pearlescent and it's much less opaque. And if you have zinc white anti-stain white out of your palette, and you look at it, and you did what I just did, which is you can't remember which is which.
Jesus.
I'm not saying this for your help, I'm just saying I'm going to let you know. I'm going to rub this off my finger. That's a super rubble pattern, but that is my auto-pitch video. So if you can't tell which black is your black or which white is your white, that's the thing that happens to artists for all. But yeah, I'm taking off my team. Like, I'm going to miss real quick because the studio is super dry today.
Super dry.
Dry over hot will start to, it's the moisture level in the air over the heat that will start to dry out the paint. It's a micro mixture with water in it. It's nothing like crazy or special. So now I've got this number 8 cat tongue. You could use a filter, you could use a round. I just want a brush that's going to give me a bit of a soft edge. And I'm going to create, this is going to be the, I'm going to add even a little white to this because this is such a subtle difference between this background and this here. And I have to give myself a horizon line so I know where it's at. So we'll say about the halfway mark. I didn't have a good T-square. I'm going to box it to my canvas by the halfway point by hand. Not my best. I could just use a T-square to make sure your stuff is level.
Would you like your giant T-square?
Well, no, but it's okay. So freaking it in. That's just bad. I want to go back. Before I get to you now, I have this really little T-square. It's plastic and super easy to use. And then I have a professional T-square from my old days of painting. It is not easy to use. But basically, if you just divide your canvas, I'm going to use a white color pencil in half. You have your white color to re-level. And that's why you would do that. And you can see, for me, that's a big deal. So, a really good level line. I was actually just admiring our skills, keeping really straight lines. Not necessarily my skill set. But now that I have this, I'll keep that more defined in a nice horizon line here. I need to make this sort of bank of trees that are coming down and disappearing into the mist. The left-hand side of these trees are going to be the darkest of the trees in the mist. Adding a little more white. And this is going to be 1-2 shades lighter. I am dousing my brush kind of up and down, and I am showing trees behind here. There we go. Now you can paint this in. Just painting it in. And already, the acrylic ground is going to help us. I even add white into this just to keep it super light. We're just trying to keep this super light. See how we're keeping it super light? The trick here is about making a shade of gray that is not much darker than your background. It also helps to make your tree line uneven. As I'm coming over, painting this in, right? As I'm going to come over, I'm going to add more and more white to this because this even starts to fade into everything as it comes down here. And it's faintly here, but just faintly, guys. Just faintly.
So
that's what you've got to do. In this, it's the best one. This value and this value being super close together. You know how we're doing that?
Yeah.
That's our first bit of mist that we're working.
No.
I'm going to take this. We can even lighten that a little more.
On a scale of 1 to 3, what do we, how difficult is this?
So I don't know. Normally we just say this with 2 hoops because there's nothing in the structure that's difficult to paint. I think the most difficult shape is the boat.
Yeah.
But the technique could feel difficult. So I would say person by person, I'll probably put it in the 3-hoop list, but I would say many of you will find this to be a 2-hoop painting.
No, we call them hoots because that's little owl hoots.
Right. So you say,
what hoot would be for a anyone who's just starting. And two hoots would be, is, you know, maybe what, you painted a couple paintings, you kind of understand some stuff.
Yeah.
And then three hoots are if you kind of know what paints are and some mixing and some, you've done a little bit of this stuff, got a couple paintings under your belt, you're ready to try something. A little complex, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
So you can just see they were bringing a little soft edges here by value. Coming back. And then working this back, making these little tree lines. It's just a little duck. And I gave you guys a black and white. You can, a PDF flash with John Deere too. I just said, John, hey, would it be okay if they had black and white? But that will help you see the values too. So I'm just making sure that this edge feels soft and blended and we have a nice kind of misty gradation. So once I have that kind of going, and I look and I'm like, oh, look, here it is. Awesome. I did. Now on here, I'm going to take still just along this horizon line, a little bit of that color, getting into my white. I just want to make sure that at the water's edge, there's just a slightest little markation. Right. Now I'm going to rinse my brush out. I'm doing an interesting thing here. I'm going to come along with my original background sky color into its very, very light form and just make sure this is cleaned up right here. Very, very light thing. You want it to be almost a reflection of what's above it. Cleaning that up. Because it's nice to keep these things clean. So it's again just a and all of my water, when I'm talking about the glass of the water, I'm going to be stroking back and forth horizontally. That's a super important thing when you're doing this because even if you put reflections in, just even the slight variances in streaks going back and forth horizontally will play against our vertical reflections and give the effect of a lake mirror. And that's also going to add to how our landscape comes together. Now, when I'm landscape painting, I like to often paint the furthest objects back and then pull them forward. And since we don't have linear perspective here, that would be like how a road disappears on the horizon and those lines converge together. What we have is atmospheric perspective. So how I'm going to say, how you're going to say that these trees are far away at home, doing things like this mist effect, where this value and this value are close together, these objects are indistinct and blurred and grayed out. As we're moving forward through our objects, they're going to be coming more and more into focus, and then the objects up in our focal area are going to be highly focused, making this piece feel very real to us. And that's just about seeing ourselves in the journey and, you know, taking steps at a time and building things up.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to put out a little more paint color that I have. So I'm going to put out some yellow ochre, which I like. I almost did some yellow ochre, but I added the Indian because there's some high yellows that we need to capture, and I didn't want to use tan. It's too intense and saturated, and in a misty landscape, it would be probably the most challenging yellow to use. You have to really gray cat yellow, something like that, purple, to even start to use it in a misty landscape. So I'm just going to say, like, you know, if you guys have the nap maple yellow, good. Landscape painting yellow. But for this, we definitely want to keep these yellows not kind of it'll pull that forward in the canvas or glow that much. I want a different kind of glow.
Now, I was slightly distracted there because I was putting the links to to the black and white and color PDF in the chat. So, I put those references in there for you. They're on the Archer page as well. And we'll be making sure that after the broadcast, all that is double checked and working correctly. Oh, here's a quick question. Could you use Naples Yellow instead of Indian Yellow?
No, Naples Yellow is not the one I added. More of the one that Golden has is still, it's not the right yellow. You could use a yellow deep. You'd want a yellow deep. You want a transparent yellow deep.
Yeah.
And if you didn't have Indian Yellow, I might just try to do it all with the yellow ochre.
Just so you know, Sam, we have over 500 wonderful Sherpazoids out here hanging out with us today, painting along
a
beautiful, misty,
Benedict
boat scene. And you know what that means?
What?
Is that I get to see all those beautiful paintings up there posted on our Facebook. And that's my most enjoyed morning thing to do is to go look at all those paintings.
What's
so,
the thing that you see on my cap?
What did you do?
A spacey one that's in my cap.
Squeezed into what?
Squeezed into my cap.
Yes, that happens.
So now I'm going to dig it out. So sometimes these tubes, they squeeze in your cap when I go dig it out. I just show you these things because maybe you're more than
that. Well, because we're live.
All of a sudden, I'm going to set up. So what I put out is that some titanium white. Over here is zinc white. You can kind of see even here on the palette, you can tell how it's zinc versus titanium. We know the finger test. I have yellow ochre and Indian yellow. This is a treat if you have it. If you don't have it, just do everything with yellow ochre. I have burnt umber, burnt sienna, phthalo green, offering blue, marsh black. So this is the palettes that are out. And if I need it, I've got some glazing medium, which is this stuff, and I live for it and I love it. We don't really need it. I'm going to get a number 4 cast on. I'm going to make another distant revelation. So I've got this gray that I used earlier. I'm going to come over here and I'm going to get just a smidge of my yellow. Oh, just a smidge. It's a very powerful color. And I don't want it to be too different of a color. And I'm going to sit there and say, there's a little bush. There's a little bush here, and it comes up. And I'm just sort of wiggling my brush back and forth, my number 4 capstone. Okay. I'm going to take it down. I'm dry brushing almost. And I get a little moisture on there. I'm going to put just a smidge more yellow. Just the top of this with just a smidge more yellow. Smidgey. So I've got just my pure gray, like a bit smidge in my burnt umber. Smidges are going to be like your whole mood now. You'd be like, what are you doing? People come by and you're like, I'm smidging. I can't talk, I'm smidging. Perfectly reasonable reason to not take colors. Smidging colors can't address other things than your smidging. So I'm going to just see how I've got kind of yellow at the top and another good brush you could do this with is my cloud brush. Get a little more yellow in there. But it's just very grayed. And so the two ways that we can make it light and distant is dry brush it so there's a lot of canvas going through. Or we mix the colors so close to the color in front of it that it seems like it's going through. So now we've got this little distant bush. How's that going? Looks like parallel close. Starts to look okay.
Oh, it looks like a distance.
Yeah, something you know, you might be like, oh my gosh.
It's so scrubbly little bush.
Scrubbly little bush. I'm going to move back up to my number 8. I'm going to take a little of my. Now, I did say green because I just didn't want you guys to have to go buy another green. It it's a bit saturated, so we're going to have to work to knock it back. So I'm adding some burnt umber to my pale green. And I'm going to come start graying that out. So see, I'm making it sort of deep and gray. You can absolutely, at this point, use paint on this base color, or brown. This is about finding these muted colors. So this little bit of land, when it comes here, comes up, it's like a little finger that comes across your canvas, right? This little finger of land. Distant little bank of grasses and fall marshes that are happening.
Now, earlier on, you were saying that zinc white and mixed white are not the same.
They're not exactly the same, and you can see that in their pigment formulation, but they both are the transparent white. They can be the same. So paint companies can name their tube of paint anything they want. If you're looking for zinc white, what you're functionally looking for is PW4. If your tube says PW4, PW4 is zinc white. If it says something else right here, it is another thing, and sometimes they are. But the reason, it's not like I don't know exactly like robotics and stuff like that, but what I also know about my industry is that things are labeled emotionally as well as factually.
That was a total switcher moment.
Okay.
I'm looking at the wrong screen.
Well, and sometimes you're on the right screen, but I can't see because it doesn't show like my monitor. All right, so we are just making this little finger. This is the basis of our finger. See how just it's not very bright. It's not very saturated. Saturation, bright colors, we pull this object forward, even if it was a brown bright color. Believe it or not, you can take ultramarine into your umber. Look at how that makes the most incredible distant gray.
Mm-hmm.
Just start working little value into the left side of the bank. Something you might notice is that there's this fog over here, but the left side of the bank fog is a little darker. The right side of the bank fog, and then as we come forward, these elements are not in fog and are therefore more saturated. Your deal. It just lets you know where the fog bank is. Atmospheric perspective. And I'm just looking at these values. Close to the bank, I'm going to darken this. So I'm going to get my brush tipped in water. I'm going to come and pull. I haven't rinsed it though, I just tipped it in water. A little of the ultramarine into my burnt umber. And I'm going to come along this and I'm going to darken this. This is going to be a little bit of work. Guys, don't worry. This is just about, what do I got to do? I got to darken my bank at the water's edge. I can deal with that. Darken my bank at the water's edge. Kind of lighter up top. Right? So now I've got this basic shape that's happening right here. It's starting to look a little distant. It's starting to be a little bit bad. What else can I do? I think I'm going to actually grab a bright. I have control. And I might grab a softer bright. I'm going to get a black pearl, number 4. And I'm going to, and this would be a good time to put out glazing medium. Out. Nice fog. So this flows down. This one is satin. You could use gloss, you could use semi-gloss. It slows down the drying time on my paint and lets me glaze. But not all products do this, so you know, just be aware they don't all work the same. So I'm just lifting my brush up and then I'm adding some glaze. So I have a very transparent tint. and I'm going to, from my bank, as vertically as I can, and no, I am vertically challenged. It's like not even a small thing. I'm going to come on here and a vertical pull reflection. I may come and add some stronger thoughts and reflections. Right now, just pull this down. Let it be streaky. Streaky is your friend. Again, in oil that you'd have, this would still be super soft. It'd be hard to get these hard edges. But we're going to lean into what our paint does, not struggle too much about what it's not doing. If that makes sense.
Totally.
Now I have this nice little reflection here. I'm going to come and get a little of my brown into my dark color. And I'm going to work just this edge again. Just making sure that I have a crisp edge here between the waterline and that reflection. So I've got all this going here, and I can start working my brush into my ochre. But my brush is dirty, right? So I've got my brass knot color on my brush. I'm working it into my ochre. You can see it's meeting it. I can get my zinc, which isn't going to, if I did white, it would just cream it out. And I don't want it creamed out. I want the color to be the color. And I'm going to start putting little bits of this yellow out my bank. Just tapping this down. There's a bit of a brighter rise right here. And I'm just looking at my reference to determine where my objects are high, where my objects might be low, you know, where they're placed. Where is my yellow place? I've got some here in the middle. Now I might come get, interestingly enough, I might get some burnt sienna, but you can see that's so bright, isn't it?
Yes.
Get a little of your ultramarine blue. And your zinc. You don't want anything that bright in any of this space. This isn't going to make it up. Tapping the shapes. Now, I don't have to make a photograph here. What I have to do is create the shapes and values of the object. Maybe a little burnt into this. Here's a little bush shape right here. Super soft, isn't it, though? It's too saturated, when you make it, it'll pull it forward. It's a little of the green. I haven't even rinsed out my brush.
Why is that?
Because I'm trying to keep it from getting really pigmented and saturated. If it gets bright, like this is so bright, I'm not going to like that result. I'm going to add a smidge of my Indian yellow to the weapon. But if you don't have it, just make it yellow ochre. You'll be happier. Don't try to switch it for CAD. I'm just looking at the little graph here. A little grasp in here. Just looking for places that this would be graphy, right?
Yeah.
With the graphs, it's tough to kind of check them out. You can also, believe it or not, a lot of people are like, oh, we never use that. That's not true. The reason a lot of instructors will advise students not to use black is black can overwhelm the canvas, but it is a perfectly good landscape tool.
Canvas is like, whoa, that black is too much.
Huh?
Just overwhelmed by the black.
It can be. I mean, look at it, but see how the feeling is coming forward. How are how our distance is. So I'm feeling like I'm going to come back. Just a little zinc on my breath. Wherever you feel stuff got a little brighter away from you, you can absolutely zinc it out. You know what I'm
doing? So,
that's it. Softened it. Wiping off my breath, grabbing a little zinc, just zinc it out.
So, you don't want strong shadows or highlights in your landscape, huh?
Not when you're doing a misty, misty landscape.
It seems like you're referring to like yellow ochre instead of cad, browns instead of blacks, and like the transparent whites instead of titaniums.
Let's see how that's doing. Oh, see, it's starting to push back.
So that's really interesting. Your color choices there.
It just keeps you going.
Now, Lori, she likes to
laugh.
Is it better to work flat or? Is it easier to work flat or on an easel?
It really depends on your physical limitations and your space. I really enjoy working on an easel, but I have a gel mat under my feet, so my legs aren't in any pain, and I don't have any reasons why working on an easel would not be my friend. I feel like I'm loving that. I'm loving that reflection. I'm loving that there. You know, I'm loving it. Come here, it's a little bit quiet and soften. Especially out here towards the tip. There we go. Those all soften. That's a nice reflection. Come and pick up a little of your ochre. You need to. And a bunch of your glaze, and pull some of that color in to some of your reflection, making your reflection multi-tonal. Super nice, yeah? All right. So this is really good. I am not putting the weird little tree here.
Weird little tree?
Yeah, there's a weird little fuzzy tree, but it's going to go south for everybody.
The shadow in the reference image?
Yeah. It just would not be a happy thing.
The shadow tree.
So you can put it in, but what it is it's such a recognizable object. And so what it is, it's a duck bush. It looks exactly like a tree. The problem with the difference between a photograph and a painting is that photographs really speak to our eyes differently than paintings do. And if you put an object in that looks exactly like the shape of a small oak tree, but it's in the wrong, like, it's this small, but clearly in the middle ground, and it's kind of fuzzy, it's going to mess with you. What I mean is this little dude right here.
Yeah, like that.
Yeah, see how it looks like a perfect little tree? Right, this is one of these bushes. You can add a little bush here, but if you add this little tree shape, you're not going to like. Not at all.
Well, you know what is loving it?
Sure.
500 Sherpas always are hanging out here with us today.
Amazing.
Your time.
Using a little bit of the yellow right here. Alright. I'm going to see you again.
Okay. All right, there you are. You're back.
Yep. Now, I'm missing my power again because it has been out here for a minute. And we get to start putting our next layer of landscape in, which is pretty fun. And again, as we move forward, this piece will start to come together. Believe it or not, it is in this space right here, in this space, that this whole painting happens. And a little bit in this wonderful bright yellow.
Oh, yeah, I can see that.
Because you can see, like, how bright this grass actually is, and you kind of see that here. This is what this is all about. So these are the things that we have to nail to make this thing work. That being said, we have this nice little landscape shape. I'm going to take a little of my brown and a little my yellow poker, and I might gray it with a smidge of my outline. A lot of new painters will not enjoy offering blue as a landscape color, and a lot of experienced landscape artists will not enjoy yellow blue as a landscape color. And the reason for that is that ultramarine tends not to overwhelm the space with its pigment, whereas yellow does. And so if you're outside painting light, you don't want to be messing with your phthalo, knocking it back. And that's actually what seems to be some discrepancy between the painters about whether phthalo blue or ultramarine. And it's really just about your comfort with the color. If that makes sense. Yeah. All right, so that is sort of a little space. And I know that there's this little landscape. It comes from slightly above my horizon line. And it keeps that here. And it can come back. Maybe I'll push it out. I think I'm going to push this corner out too far. Push it back. Sometimes I'm looking like, push that out too far. And I'm going to make a little peninsula of something going off into this part and coming back here. So what I'm doing is I'm just sort of observing the shapes and putting them in and saying, all right, I gotta have something like this. Now I'm gonna add some of my zinc to this. It's gonna give me this sort of beige, but not overwhelming beige. And I'm going to just start this little landmass here because it has some of that in it. Let's talk about my landmass a little bit. Not too much yet. Not too much. And then there's this cool thing that's happening. I'll get my black on here. And I'm going to just be a crazy person and freak him out. There's this cool little tree. And it in my canvas, like this. Now, I have some lines I don't like, so I'm going to just go back with my background color, because I know I've got a lot of tree over it, and just paint that part out. I don't like to worry about it too much, because there's a lot going on here. Sometimes I don't mind if I sketch and paint, I'm just going to say, oh, there's a thing basically here, and I don't mind it, and there's that object there. And then also, by the object, is this sort of, let's take a little green and a little ultramarine together. And then we will work that into this burnt umber. And I'm going to say that there is sort of mess of plants and things that are happening. You can kind of see where they are. So we can sort of work that in. It's very dark. I find it's nice to take a brush and sort of wiggle it and soften these edges. Again, soft edges are hardest to get in acrylic, and your friend if you can learn to get them. And then we have hard edges so easily. So it's the ultimate medium because it does all things.
All things.
All things. Put it into. Maybe go into my capstones. Worked in fairly quickly. This is just layer one, right? Now, the difference between this and some of the other objects in the space is that it actually does need to be quite dark. So, I'm not really going to use that much black, but I might in this add even a little bit to deepen.
So, anyone who would like to know, if this is your first time painting this.
Yes. No, sorry.
What'd you do?
Almost spilled the water cup.
What?
Yeah, I can see that, but it was all just a real moment up in here. But that's okay. I'm just going to landscape paint today and explain to you how to landscape paint. Pretty much what that impacts me is if I don't rehearse it, if you get to see me, you're more likely, if I don't rehearse it, for you to get to see me have an organic moment where I have to rethink something. And the feedback from you guys is sometimes those moments are incredibly helpful.
Yeah.
And I only cut off about 10 minutes with rehearsal on the overall kind of painting time when I'm like, okay, there'll be no, I got to erase the treatment, there's no working any of it out. And I kind of waited out, and sometimes, not all the time, sometimes I like to rehearse so we can, really enjoy a project like that, but sometimes it's nice for you guys to see me process that out. I'm going to take my all-screen back over to my Burt number, and we'll work them together again. And I think I'm going to add even a little black into this mixture, and I'm going to work my trunk. So at this, the trunk will be darker. So the interesting thing I've got to do. So my trunk will be darker at the base, and I'm going to let this dry brush out a bit as I go up. So not only is it going to get thinner as it goes up, but it has to get lighter because it's going into fog.
If I could, your hat just perfect.
And I'm going to add some sink to my brush because I want to take this trunk up, but I've got to lighten it as it goes up into the fog. This tree to have the effect of being in the mist. So that's something as a new painter you might not be aware of, is that this tree, some of this low zone doesn't have any fog, and some of this higher zone does. So to do the tree, we have to do it somewhat in the fog. The lower trunk is not so much in the fog. Weird deal. I know. So I'm just trying to work that out. Myself, this one's sort of trunk shape. And again, if I need to, I will come around with the Muse Sky color and clean up anything that is not quite what we're looking for. And it doesn't hurt to clean space back up. So if your brush doesn't give you the line you're wanting, if you come in early enough, a lot of times you can do what's called biting back. And I can bite back the painting with the background color. Not always possible, but in this particular case, highly possible. See, I can clean this up. And that's a nice thing. So I'm going to take a little of my burnt into this dark color that I can make to give me my sort of trunk color. I've got a little white on my brush. I'm going to start lightening the trunk on the left-hand side of it. What's interesting is light sources on paintings like this can be hard to determine, but this particular painting's light source is shown to us by inside the bowl, by the cast of light across this grass and this tree trunk. So if you're a new artist and they'll ask, oh, where's your light source, and it's a foggy day, all the objects may not tell you the light sources, but something will. And you want to just make sure that you have access to those. Nice little tree trunk showing the light source.
Just rough spot on the canvas where it's hard to see over your left shoulder.
I'm so sorry.
No, it's okay. I'm just letting you know that.
This is happening.
I'm having to cut between some angles here.
All right, so I'm going to take a little of my burnt umber in my silver green and a little of my porcelain blue to it. And this is going to be my grayed out color. I'm going to see how bright this is. I need it to not be this bright. So I may even black to it because it's got to be muted. There we go. So a lot of times you'll see me mixing colors. See, I've got very bright lights going to add a little bird scanner. Perfect. So, I have very bright lights. Can make it super hard. The top of the tree is the most misted. I'm going to bring a little branch out. Maybe a little branch out. Just stroke down softly. Stroke down branch shape. And this is just a little downward strokes. You can make a little of my mix this together there. I'm coming down. Making sense to everybody. Is everybody feeling confident with this? It's just about. So in painting, things are high-hat, low-key. These paintings we have coming up, I got real excited about because they're all very high-hat. So I'm back into this picture here I did and back into the green and brown. I'm just going to look at my tree shape. Brush strokes are real light, and so you're starting to be a tree. Be a tree. Be a tree. It's fun to have a tree. He's got a nice dark branch coming down here, and if I need to, I can get my trunk mixture even blended into the green.
Now, when you say high-hat, you mean, can you use it a little better?
So high-hat is when my colors are very bright and don't have very dark or low tones. Mm-hmm. And I have these three branches. I'm more misted over here. Out of the room, I'm brushing my trunk back a little bit. So when you see like a lot of the romantic paintings, they don't have like a very dark. The darkest dark is maybe a soft blue. It's like these blues and violets for shadows, and they don't go into the deep dark colors.
I remember the way you described it to me, it really helped was if you were to say that you're on a scale of 1 to 10, your lights and darks, high hat only uses 1 to 5.
That's exactly, yes.
Is that right?
That is exactly right. I'm putting out some little branches here.
Once I thought of it that way, it made it really easy for me to see those. Because then, you can see the paintings where there's just no dark shadows. It's just even their dark shadows are really brightly lit.
Yeah. Even the dark shadows will be very brightly lit. So that's going to be a lot of fun for us today. I'm going to do some little rough branches coming off my tree. So it's a rough tree. Back in here. You can spend some time with the full tree. Get to know him. Let's see how it looks on the way back. Because he looks kind of rough at first, but then as we get into it, we start to see him happen. Just adding a little of my darker gray now in here. But not too much, taking it steps at a time, right? Steps at a time. We don't want to be too much with this color. Looking at it again, because I can't back up. Okay, so now we have a tree that's sort of in the distant mist. We've got some banks that are coming forward. We've got some grass land we've got to do. And he's got some interesting little grasses that are happening. So I'm going to take a little of my Indian yellow and mix it into my, believe it or not, ultramarine blue. I'm going to tone it with some burnt umber. And I'm going to start talking about, I'm going to start dashing in some of these distant grasses that we have, the sort of value. That's nice. I need a, I take my burnt umber into my yellow ochre, right? And I add a smidge of ultramarine to it.
No.
If you didn't have white, I had a lot of white to do in this highlight.
Sorry. If you didn't have a capstone, what would you set?
Silver, round, bright. Really, honestly, what you want is a brush that you have control over. So silver would be my first choice. If I didn't have a silver, I'd paint with a round. And if I didn't have the round, I'd paint with a bright. For soft kind of landscapey edges. Trying to make sure this little background one is knocked back a bit. So I'm going to actually switch to bright right now. So just be crazy. I'm going to take a little of my burnt sienna and my ultramarine. Knock it back with a little of my fine tune. You can even get a little of the Indian vanilla in there. And I'm going to start. I'm just pulling this brush stroke up, like, so here's, like,
is it possible to scoot the canvas and switch the silhouette? Just while you're working on that part.
Did that help?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah. It's just on that right hand side of the canvas. It gets a little far out of the way.
I hear you.
I mean, the right hand side of the canvas.
Just pushing this up a bit. Kind of see that. I'm going to get a little of my ochre. My brush is super dirty. Got this nice sort of crazy green down here. Starting to pull this in together. Pulling it together. If I take my green yellow, my ultramarine, this nice green, I'll come over here. And I'll come back. See, now I've got my, land out. Land out. Now I'm going to get my, without rinsing my brush, I'm going to get a little of my phthalo green and add a little Indian yellow to it. Maybe even, there you go, a little thing. I'm going to tap just a little highlight of this. A little bit of land right here. Just a soft little bit of the green here. Maybe a little bit of it right here. Wipe this out. Catch my breath.
George just
fill it up with Indian yellow.
George just asked one of the best questions I've seen. It's like a very good new painter question.
Oh, my dear.
How do you use a shader, and what is it good for? I felt that too, exactly.
What is this for? Now when it's labeled, that would be easy. Help everyone. Oh, hold on. Now I'm gonna do a crazy thing. I'm gonna lay a little white onto my brush, and this is titanium white. And I'm gonna come here, and I'm gonna tap along this shoreline. A little bit of this highlight color. Just a little bit.
Now, to answer George's question, we're going to put together some videos talking about individual brushes and stuff. Just real quickly, what is the difference between a shader and like bright?
A shader is a little bit longer length out. It often kind of comes in not quite as a filter, but it tapers in a bit. And it is about having a softer edge. I'm going to grab a little of my white. Nope. Bright.
You're using all golden paint today, right?
I am using all golden paint.
Okay. They were just asking about some of the different brands, the colors.
There we go. Found it.
blue titanium wine to make zinc wine?
No.
No.
You could add titanium white into a glaze to make a glazed titanium white. I have made a very dark color. I'm going to add some of my dark bodies back to this glaze. Not a lot, just a little bit. Just feeling a little more here. I'm going to let this rest on it while I'm thinking about it, and then I'm going to resolve my trees. So I know that seems like a little crazy, and it's not, I make no money on zinc wines. I'm just trying to give the best possible honest answer that I can. I'm going to take a little of my vanilla to my off-mine. And it with a little burnt umber. I'm going to start tapping little bits of highlight. And actually, it looks like my tree could use another. See, it's quite dark in the tree. I can go even darker in this tree. So I'm going to take off my, all of that, come into the tree and go even darker. I'm going to go even darker. More. So, a lot of times the stuff is deep because it needs to be made. But you can fake it sometimes, right? So it's like if you're very familiar with all your products and you know you don't have any zinc white and you need to glaze something back and cream it out, you might possibly add some titanium white to the glazing medium or gel medium or whatever clear, transparent works with your acrylic paint medium on your palette that day. Yes. There we go. Now I'm gonna move to my next value. So I'm taking that dark color I made and adding some of the Indian yellow. So Indian yellow is very glazed, and that's why I like it for this. And I'm going to start picking up the highlights of this tree. They're not great, they're not overwhelming. I'm picking the right edges because we learned where our light source came from our tree trunk and our boat and our other bank. And we're just going to enjoy highlighting our little tree on the right-hand side. Got to back up and see how that's looking. Starting to take some shape. Needing to put up some more Indian yellow is what I'm needing to do. And collect it.
You're a little ball. It's a little one.
It's a little one.
It's a
really good big cap.
I say a little. It's not the littlest one, I think, to me.
No, I think it's the littlest one.
Is it?
Yeah. If you're Jim Carrey, you get these colors in gallons just for the amount. I'm not going to give Jim Carrey any grease. I'm not even saying I'm not worried. Because that more, he's got the paint hookup.
Just say it. If you were the current experiential incarnation of Jim Carrey in this state, you would enjoy the abundance. Present to express yourself.
Shit. See how long Bela Green it took to just saturate this color? Crazy.
If there was one self to express.
If there was.
And not just. But I don't know, we won't go too deep into the gym thought process.
So I'm just tapping.
I like it though.
Little facial highlights on this tree. Where a few branches are. They're highlighted in the picture. I'm leaving lots of the dark involved.
That's a really good question. This is, I like this question a lot. Whoever asks, is any paint not marked titanium white zinc white?
Yeah.
So if it's not marked titanium white, it's zinc white?
Oh, no. Yeah. I'm sorry. That was like, what is the
That's a trick question. I want to make sure you got it. So
no.
It's not all white.
No. There's a lot of white. There's red white. There's Chinese white. There's good.
There's pigments of all different colors that you use.
I don't know what's best about white.
Yeah. And so, like, lead white is a traditional white that was used.
Oh, yeah, that's the best white. You can really only get it if you're an oil painter right now and you're really expensive one.
And regional, you know, regional whites that you can only get, like, you know, from right using pottery or bone.
Yeah.
You know, is bone white?
Yeah, it's very involved. In acrylic. Unless you're into Golden or Holbein or one of the top paint companies, you get just a couple whites. Let's see how that's looking. So what I've done is I've just tried to create some spaces where a little bit of sunlight we're getting has caught that tree. That's there. And I still feel like I could push this grass back, so I'm going to just zinc it. Now, I get to do a really fun reflection, which I like. Which is.
What makes it fun?
Reflections are always enjoyable. I don't know if they actually are, but literally, I love the effect to get to very little effort. So I had my aquamarine in my Indian yellow over here, and I added a little brimstone and a little black pepper to kind of tone it back so that I could do grass blue. I'm going to switch over to my bright, and I'm going to work my bright into that color and pull my glaze. If you need a little more brown, don't feel afraid to put in. And I'm going to pull down the first part of my reflection. That's the one.
Oh, you have to scoop the canvas. Oh,
sometimes I get leaning in for my comfort.
Oh, no, it's okay if you're leaning. Just scoop the canvas over there.
That's a funny thing that I do. So I am pulling down, I just grabbed a little more burnt ember and I'm pulling down this reflection that is in the water. You can take your brush on the edge, and I'll pull it down across here to the next landmass. Now I'm going to say two things. I did a smudge here, and that's going to throw off my whole thing. So I'm going to do a little of my background mix again. Just make sure I'm back to the super light, light tone. Okay. Just get that little green now, because that's my friend. And the other thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to get some just white on this brush. And then I'm going to come here and I'm going to tap a little reflection here.
Oh, that looks nice.
This little bank has one before the reflection pulls down. And that's a nice thing that you can see. And it's really quite lovely. So, with this bank and the other bank, I think you guys are like, man, this landscape, see what this crazy idea, I've never looked at it again.
No, I was really enjoying this.
I don't know.
You've got over 515 people here to paint with you.
I am not taking my black and my Indian yellow.
So, thank you guys for hanging out, by the way. That's pretty awesome.
It is pretty awesome.
Pretty awesome.
Adding a little of my titanium white to that. And I'm going to make this bank, which is going to come here. So it's a little bit kind of, it actually encroaches on this reflection a little bit. Move down here. A little bit wider here. And then there's a bunch of that happens. So I'm going to brush this to the right, just lightly. And I'm going to work all the things on this one's dark shapes. That's crazy. Look at what that black does with that Indian yellow. Makes a really nice landscape green. like, you can't really take black out of the landscape scenario. You just have to realize that you can't use it heavy-handed. Now, this one is, interestingly enough, a brighter green, so I'm going to take, I'm not going to rinse my brush, I'm going to load it up with a little of my Esterine Blue. And my eating wall can come here and say, okay, so we've got this bit of weird landscape nonsense that's coming out. Let's just get that in. Let's just get that in. Lots of grass story to tell here, so. So now I'm starting to get some levels. And it won't hurt us.
It's a
safe cut. I'm not even rinsing my brush. A little of our ultramarine blue and our black. Talk a little bit about this deep space that's happening here. Right over here. Because there is this little break of something that's going on. And it might as well be drawing and happening, right? Because we're going to put some grass in. We're going to put some grass in. I'm going to need a sip of coffee and sip of and fresh water. It is a good time to get fresh water. How are you guys doing?
They're doing great.
We're getting through.
So, I'm not sure who it was. Somebody mentioned Stroopwafels to me in chat, and I don't know if you remember those, but Edwin used to send me those waffles that were filled with yummy delicious.
I do.
So they're talking about how everybody loves those.
Well, there's nothing not to love. You were crazy for them back when you could eat them.
Was it coffee and more than a Stroopwafel?
No, it's not coffee and a Stroopwafel.
Yes! Well, if you didn't know, they were perfectly round, so you put them on top of your coffee, and they warm up, and the coffee warms them up. Okay, so now they really want to have Stroopwafels, too. Did I meet you?
Huh?
Oh, yeah.
No! I just said it myself! I was just ready to express your joy about Stroopwafels.
I think he was rambling.
Okay. I am painting the reflection. I'm using, this is a number, is a quarter inch angle silver brush. This is a ring satin. If you paint with my mom, you totally know what this is. And I'm going to just, I'm just painting in this little reflection that we have in the water of this tree. It'll be nice, it's a nice touch later, and it's going to make our landscape feel so much more real. And I'm just feathering this edge so it's soft. Again, I'm not painting with oil paint, so it's super challenging for me to get those soft edges, and I have to use different tricks. Can I impose on you? Can we do our break thing and I'll get coffee and fresh water? Everybody, take a minute and stretch. This is an involved thing, and we're not breaking it into segments. So definitely work your shoulders, work your neck, breathe in, breathe out. It's a good time to give yourself a body break, a body break, a snack break. So let's have 3 minutes for that and meet back here to finish up this painting.
Let's see what we can do.
White sand, blue bay, hand in hand, slept there for days. Light wind, green haze. Eye to eye, we parted ways. Meet me under the ocean. Save me from half-stepped hard shells, shallowest sparks in Dave's wells. Help me catch my breath, we're getting higher. Imagining your face, you're my desire.
I don't know if I have a word.
Forever be.
A little break, a little coffee, a little stretcher. It's important to keep stretching those things because when you're working your mom, you can really like lose yourself in the pain process and work much longer than you think. And believe it or not, we're closer to being done than you might know. So I have to be
good. Okay, everything's good other than it's kind of a. I didn't have a perfectly smooth transition back.
Oh, I think we are not talking about flawless today at all, are we? That's not a goal today. Not a goal.
I'm working on it.
You're so good.
I want to have a perfect broadcast.
You're doing so good. I'm mixing ultramarine blue and burnt sienna. Okay, so if you look right here. Look right here, there's a slight rough color to the grass.
Yeah.
And if you look right here, there's a very deep umber in the grass. I'm going to be using this in both places. I'm going to start here, and I'm going to just take my number four cat's tongue and very loosely a upward stroke. So this is my depth value. This is going to be kind of what I'm doing now as I'm coming forward. My information, like back here, things were loose and in the script. As I move forward in the painting, the way that I'm painting will become more informed and more descriptive. I'm just enjoying this. Now, I could go through here faster, maybe with a fan brush. But there's really only one fan brush that paints with acrylic that we paint. So, And I'm still making this stroke. So I say stroke. There we go. I can also do it if I have one of these. This is another really great brush to do this with. Super fun. Because what you're talking about is small and sharp. And small and sharp is a powerful, powerful thing. Powerful, powerful thing is a small and sharp brush. So just any way that you're getting through here. What you don't want to make is regimented little railroad tracks. Just blowing around. I mean, look at the grass here. It's going different directions. And it's not grow in line with itself. So if you paint stuff that's growing in line with itself, it's not going to be what you're hoping for. I'm going to add a little of my Indian yellow, which is going to green this up a bit. And then I'm going to come out here. And I'll make it a little more some little dark grasses out into my water. Even here, I'm going to pull the edge of this, pull some of these little grasses out into dark water. Mm-hmm. I'm having flow problems in there. Get my brush in the water and keep going.
Are you using an angle brush?
I am using a quarter inch angle brush. You could use the cast iron, anything that's going to give you these little lines. Just going to put this right here. Maybe my hand is just coming out a little bit. Just making sure that I've got this going in my water. Now, on top of that happening in my water, you need to have, anywhere you have these little guys coming up, pull a little reflection down. See? A little bit. Not a lot, just a little bit. You need it. Just starts to happen. I'm going to go back to my number four because I was really enjoying that experience. So what I have to do, I'm going to get I have a little of my green yellow over here into my ultramarine blue, and then I take it over to my burnt sienna. I get this sort of deep grass color. I'm going to make sure that this side has a bunch of this just kind of going on. I'm just using my reference to really feel confident in what I'm talking about when I'm putting my glasses. Just making sure this is filling in. So the reason I'm being kind of like broad with where I'm putting this is because I've got to fill in some values as I'm moving forward. So I might even add some of this kind of titanium white even here. As I'm moving forward. So I have this weird, all the grass has this weird yellow cast to it. This value here as I'm coming forward. So, if you need a darker color, you can get right back into your blue with the bank. Doing more grayed out grasses. We're just pulling this in. Will we come back with green? Yes, we will. Are we going to come back with yellow? Yes, we will. But right now, I'm pulling in the texture that tells our story. The directionality of some of this is telling our story. If there's a dark value there, you can always come with a little of your all-time blue and your burnt. So there's a deep shadow that's happening over here. I'm going to talk about stuff along that paint. We're going to keep refining. Right? You've got to keep refining it. Keep going. I'm going to sit my coffee and give it a look as it's pulling forward. So I'm starting to pull these forward. And you can see that what I've got to take is this almost into a white yellow. And then there's a bright yellow and there's a hint of green here. And I've got to start pulling and lightening this here as well. But not so much that it pulls too far forward into my canvas. The fun of being up today. It's really tempting to just pull right into big half inch angle and expand and be like, I'm not done. So this is the number 4 fan. And I just want to get some stuff laid in. Maybe it's a little quicker than I'm getting to. And I just want this texture to exist here. And so I'm going to just come here real fast. I'm not having to work so hard. That texture in.
The fan brush just shoots it right in there for you.
Yeah, it's the first layer. This is the all-terrain blue and the burnt umber. And am I going to not do the detail? Oh no, I'm still doing the detail. But if I use this now, I can shorten my time if I want to. I may not want to. Trying to get an effect of texture in. And it can be really frustrating and long.
What did you just put out there?
Ultramarine blue.
Why is that?
I was out of it.
Oh. I didn't know if you were doing some new shadow colors.
I'm going to just make sure I've got this grass sort of filled in here. You can use whatever brush you have. We're just trying to create this sort of texture. And we're going to, then once we have the texture really worked out, pressing this up. We'll go back in more with our details. I just need to start working my values in here. Like, that this yellow and this blue, and the green yellow and the ultramarine blue, and I'm going to come here and just make sure that this area has this base texture. A little more blue, even. Keeping that color very. This is a very dark area. I just want to make sure that these lines aren't hard, that they're sort of soft. I'm coming here. I'm going to just also turn the brush and stroke down. It's going to be a nice sort of grass. A little stroke helps me get my lines get sort of thought out. I am using a little more in yellow and some points. I'm going to just brush this down a little, a couple places. Just enforce that. And I'll go back to my detail brush in a second. This will help me. Let me see what that did for me. Okay, yeah, see that? So it gave me a little space there. You can do this all with one brush.
Yeah.
But sometimes it's nice to have some different tools, because especially if you have a tendency to like make a stroke, make a stroke, make a stroke, and you're having trouble sometimes switching to the brushes will help you break up that stroke repetitiveness. It's like I've got to say most stroke repetitive, and then when you change that before you start putting the highlights. It could. It was my thinking anyway. No, I totally see what you see. I'm going to work on it. It's great to see. All right, so I'm going to put out more in yellow. By the way, if you can get this color, and it does come in other, like, economy colors, I highly recommend it. It's a really wonderful color.
It's wonderful.
I'm going to take a little of my in yellow. mix in with my yellow oxide. I'm going to tint it just a smidge. And my black is nice with the Indian yellow. There we go. What I'm looking for is this nice beginning of the yellow that I'm going to be talking about here. Just keep stroking this up. I'm going to talk about this little shoreline. It's going to be really interesting because I'll have to pour a reflection down, a grass reflection. Whole kit and caboodle. So now let's get right into your yellow. And add a smidge of orange. See if we've got it now. First layer. So I'm going to just try to find the shape of the grass that I'm seeing here. Talk about that as much as I can without being too heavy-handed about it. I've got the quarter-inch angle here. You could use a detail round just as easily. Just putting this here. Now, as I'm going, I'm going to get into my zinc. Pulling some of these highlights that this yellow grass has. Just pulling it in. Get right into the zinc. Now, the grass, which is the burnt umber in ultramarine, it feels like a tiny white here. So it's almost a gray. I'm going to start pouring that a little more brown to it into this. Just starting to talk a little more detail about this area of grass. How are you doing, guys?
Really good.
Okay, I so appreciate it.
There's a lot of people who have the fan brush, so they're really enjoying having an opportunity to see and use it.
It just can be really nice to use it for some textures. We have a tap one coming up that's going to be like one hoop. It's called fan brush based.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Do these streets. Now, let's see how that comes out. So I'm just trying to, what can happen is my paint can get gummy and I just am going to go into my water. Make sure my brush is not overwhelmed by that gummy paint. I'm going to just keep going. Oh, this is a nice higher highlight. So, now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get higher highlights. I'm going to get right into my white. And I'm going to take a little bit of this, and I'm going to brush just some of this on the edge of this a little bit forward. See how I'm doing there? And then maybe some of it's going to come back. Maybe some of the other stuff not touched. I'm going to make little pockets. Not the whole thing, just little pockets. And I'm going to use my reference photo to decide where I'm going to put those. And I'm just coming right here. Look at that right there. See how it starts to happen? Okay, that was a good break. Now we're starting to get this grass mount that we think we're never going to get. I'm going to tell you that I've got my gray here. I'm going to get a little of my any nail into that gray and get some of my white. Give me kind of this gray to highlight. And I'm going to come here with this very highlight color. And I'm going to highlight some of this. All of it. Just some of it. Get some more yellow on there. All of it. Just all of it. What are we doing? Don't get it! Now there's a little more green here as we come forward between yellows, our Indian yellow, and our ultramarine blue. And we can always tone that with the umber. And if I need it to be a lot darker, I just put a lot more off-line blue and my umber. Now I want to make sure that I've got this deepened right along here. Get some of my water in that. Look at that. Not everything, just some of it. Now I'm going to start my reflections. Let's start and then we'll finish this little bad boy over here. Back into this guy. I'm going to take my green and my brown together. My glaze. And do my deal. First. Line this down. First, we pull this down. Doing that right there. I have an interesting little thing here. Sometimes I might want a little more pigment on it, so you know, make sure you change up the pigment. Now in this, I'm going to wipe this off. It's really interesting what we do. I'm going to get some just white. I'm going to come along here. My reflections. I'm going to add some just white. These are like little ripples or come out from the grasses. Push them into the grass. Gold could be impacting this. A lot of things could be impacting. These highlights are going around. We're not done here, believe it or not. Because once these highlights dry, we have to put some sharp grass reflections under that bank. How good do you like this?
Really good. This is really interesting. Wendy actually had a question for this.
Oh.
What details do you identify in a photograph?
Photographs can have a really intense depth of field. John can explain to you more, but a photographer can do things that the objects that are in focus and out of focus that we as painters probably generally don't do. Right? We use aperture perspective, which is the things that are further away are grayed out in less detail. Things that are closer are sharper focused. This traditional landscape painting for down here. So when I'm looking at this photograph and I'm thinking how I want to do that, I know I'm going to want to do this in high detail right here in my boat in high detail.
So there's a focal
point. This is a focal point to my painting. This photograph and that focal point to my painting. I'm going to have those in some considerable detail. Like you do. Some white in here so I can start grasping it up. You can always even get crazy and add yellow ochre. Too much yellow ochre. Okay, yeah.
Too much. Too much.
I know it's too much because I don't know what that is. That's not going to talk to me about dead grasses or muted colors. Talk about dead grasses and muted colors. And to do that, I'm going to need to.
Yeah, you need to inch the canvas around.
Okay.
I'm trying to access cameras and angles.
I'm trying to adjust me too.
Oh, you're doing great.
So I'm going to just make some warmer, little more lighter, brighter grasses. And then as I come back, I can get some more yellow. And then yellow, that's good. Just enjoying that. Put some of that through here. These higher grasses. Brown. Just talking about things that are happening. My glaze out. I'm going to do my glaze again, which is my burnt umber, my blue, and my glaze. Just going to pull that vertical. Vertical is important here. That would be the most important thing. And then again, we'll do the same thing. We'll come back with some more defined grasses as we can.
That'll shadow line that bank. Which is really great.
Which just really helps. The black is thinking about being a pink. Wipe off, get some pure white. Okay.
Waterline reflection.
There we go. We've got some little waterline reflections. Pull that down. If you make a mistake in waterline reflection, pull it down. It's not that big a mistake. It's crazy how that works. There we go. So we've got some waterline stuff that's happening here. We've got some waterline stuff that's happening over there. Right. We can, I want to put in some of the details here before I put in my boat, and I might put some details in over here before I put in my boat. So we know there that we get our great misty day green from our ultramarine blue and our Indian yellow, and we know we have some stronger, more thought out little grasses. Maybe like here. I'm just using this little detail brush. They're happening in the water. And you can always softly pass the reflection between these two.
Okay.
Oh, thought out little grasses in there. Oh, there's a bunch of them up right here. They're like, oh, I'm going to get some more blue, so I'm even more intense over here. Grasses that are happening right here.
There's a lot of little detail work in landscape.
Yeah, I mean, okay, so with the paint landscapes, and what I found is that I like expressionist landscapes personally, but I know when people are wanting to learn to paint, they want to learn how to just paint a landscape. And then get Lisa back later. Generally, you know, when you're wanting to learn to paint, a lot of times you're like, hey, I just want to just doing this downward, more focused. The reflections that would be happening here. Right? I'll make it some more blue and brown. And also plant some little grasses that are out here. reflecting, and these little grasses are reflecting. Yeah, put the reflection down. So we just have these little details, and the little details honestly help. Right? Now we get to think about our boat. And I'm going to sip my coffee. Well, I think about my boat, so I do my boat and my upfront grass, and then I have a pretty involved, highly desirable style painting. Can I just put 30 seconds of coffee in the microwave? Because I'm going to forget sip. So our background is misty. Our objects are out of focus, becoming more and more in saturated color and focus as they pull forward. And again, this whole painting's moment is going to be through the boat and this grass layer here. Right? Because in the painting, you've got background, middle ground, foreground. Right? And in the painting, you have negative shapes and positive shapes. So the negative shapes in our painting is all of this gray. Reflection areas, which kind of goes here, and then we have objects coming in, bisecting with the tree that bisects here and here, like this object here, the way this goes in here, the way this landscape goes in here across the boat, and the boat keeping our, so the photographer took this picture, he's thinking about the composition of all of these things relating to each other. And then as painters, we keep what we think is important and then discard what we don't love. So that's kind of how, you know, you're doing it when you're thinking about, like, how do I paint this painting? How do I do this thing? So where do I do it?
Mic on. There we go. How do you do?
You know? So, now I'm going to do the book. Now I'm going to free him a little bit in because I'm a rebel like that. I'm going to take just my, I guess I don't have any color green left, really, in my black. I'm going to just freehand a little boat. I'm a crazy person. I'm going to do it with my
hands.
Maybe not. I'll just keep going with this. We don't want it. I'm just going to first draw in.
Now, the difference between a rowboat and a canoe is subtle but important. And you sure end up with the wrong shape.
Well, that could happen anyway, so I'm going to pull my bow up and up. I'm just sort of paying attention to the full shape here, so I guess it has a little bit that comes up.
You know, what I'll say is you don't appreciate a boat until you have to row it.
Okay.
Boat design is...
If boat design is not your thing, and put traceable on the website. A little crazy with my full-shortened boat. Mm-hmm. So, my little full-shortened boat. Now, whatever boat I have here, I have to also have here in reflection. Doing kind of the opposite thing. And then since this water is pretty still, it's a pretty darn good reflection of said boat. Sometimes I like to turn upside down and just make sure that I'm
making sure your reflection is reflected.
Making sure that my reflection is as reflective as it needs to be. You'll find it doesn't have to be perfect, but there are some things that the eye just won't slug for. You know, you have to decide if you want to include the stick. I'm not going to. I do think that the mooring, because of the way it bisects here, is actually pretty awesome.
The anchor?
Yes, I'm keeping that. That's what I'm keeping. Now, since I'm not keeping the tentative green line, I'm going to go ahead and just point that into the space. Because I didn't need it. And back into this. I'm going to get my dark green with a little black.
And which brush are you using?
Number 4 capstone.
Okay.
And I'm going to just put this first layer of boat in. Paint everything up on. Boat, boat, boat. It's fun to paint boats. I like to paint boats.
Yeah.
I like to paint landscapes. They're not, unless you're doing them very loosely and expressionistically, they're not fast. And the issue about painting expressively in this way is you really got to be able to do this well before you loosen it up.
This is a good question. So, generally speaking, should reflections be darker or lighter than what the reflection?
Generally, they seem to be darker.
That's because of literally there is less light reflecting off the water than there is coming directly off the object.
That's just a good question to ask. Thank you for asking that question.
Yeah. So there's almost always a little light loss in a reflection, which is why a reflection seems just a slight bit dimmer than other objects, than the primary object. So, it's a strange thing.
Yeah, it's reflected light, so it's not all going to travel through the water.
And in some cases, the water itself will be carrying a bit of luminousness to it, so you'll be seeing some light coming from the water below the reflection in the shadow. It's so complex.
It could just be simple for us, right? I'm going to get some of my blue and my ultramarine and my black ultramarine and make sure that this space. Here, everything about where this boat reflects needs should be quite dark. Am I making it again? Okay. Let that dry for a second. I may kind of cover that. Watercolor is a very good watercolor, which means that we wasted too much pigment. That's just like where paint is dry. I've got a minute too. Okay, so I'm going to do the inside of the boat, which is interesting. I'm going to do like a little inny mill in burnt umber. I'm just going to do the whole inside of the boat initially in these two colors, and then I will age it and give it valuation. I would like to paint a base kind of deep value and then lighten it up. And then find my deepest shadow. So I can just like work through my highlights and my deepest shadows and then just keep observing it and lighting the dark thing as I see fit. But you kind of see, like, even that one's a boat.
It's a boat.
You have boat. We have boat. And I'm going to dry because I really don't want to do all my grasses because I want some of my grasses to layer over my boat. And I really don't want to do them until I kind of get the boat resolved, and then I'll pull the whole thing together with the grass. How do I like this so far?
Really good. So this is interesting. It's hard to know how much further we have to go from here.
I'm not even sure myself. So there were some really distinctive brush marks here in the distant trees, and so I'm taking some zinc in my number 8 capstone to soften it out. Yeah. It's softened. Yes. So sometimes in distant salt, if you have some really distinctive, really observable brush marks, like if they're making scratch or something, it can be a real problem. And again, there's nothing like just going back with your zinc and saying, no, indescript brush.
That's good.
Yeah. You do that with that. My paint is gone, and I'm going to save myself misery of dealing with it because it's hot in here, and I'm not working from a wet palette. So I'm going to go ahead and put out my colors again. I do need this green to the boat. It has some really, really saturated green bits on it.
So what was it you just put out there?
I put out the pale green and indian yellow. I'm putting out some ultramarine blue. I'm going to put out burnt sienna, burnt umber. going to be a fun day, too. I hope some people will come to paint all those trees with me.
Mm-hmm.
I know it can be daunting. It's a lot of trees. Hang in, man. Just think how good you're going to feel when you hang all those trees. You've got like, that holiday gift you've got to give to that person that loves natural landscape, and they're going to have no idea if that painting was even in them. You'd be blown away. Zinc white. Probably more than I actually need at this stage of the painting. Because things are getting crisper. So I don't need as much atmospheric anything as I need crisp results. Some titanium white. I need to run this one liner.
I'll get it out. Do it after this show.
After the show. So I've got white, and I probably will go ahead and give myself a little black. Lord knows I'm going to need it. All right, so we've got this here. Probably in all this chatting, this stuff is all dry because stuff is dry in the studio real quick.
Yeah.
I'm going to start working my book. So one thing my book has, I'm not going to get a smaller brush. I'm going to get this number four. And I'm going to take a little of my porcelain. Gonna have a little of my alternate and the umber. See, I'm just a little bit. Come here at the corner, and vertically go down a little bit. Right here, pull that down. Get a little of your vert, sienna, and a little alternate. Along this edge, this sort of dark line, and then I'm going to pull it down. If you need glitzy medium, which I clearly do, unplug it and put it out. Okay. Open it and put it out. Opening it always helps with glitzy. Open your bottles to dispense the dead product.
That does help.
So I'm just starting to pull it down. I'm going to take a little of my, I haven't rinsed my brush, I'm grabbing a little yellow oxide, a little of my titanium white, and I'm going to come with the weathering on the inside of my book. Can you see that there?
Oh yeah.
Wearing the inside of this boat.
Oh, yeah. Nikki says you should turn on the coffee warmer Alan gave you.
I should.
It's just right over there.
You know what's been happening, though?
I'm afraid to
turn it off.
And then we have cooked coffee. I'm going to put it on a timer.
I think I have a problem and I need help.
Actually, I should hook it up to the same circuit as the overhead lights. That way when I turn on the overhead lights, it turns off.
I like that plan. I'm going to keep this pulling down the watering. Now I'm going to do an interesting thing. I'm going to get my ochre and my white. And I'm going to come along the back here of my boat. And I'm going to come along the top edge of my boat. Even more white on the top edge of my boat. And that. See it now? And I'm going to even come along this top edge of my boat. So I'm going to take a little of my vanilla and a little of my ultramarine. I've got some white on my brush. Make it a sort of muted, rustic, yellow green. I'm going to paint this along here. I'm going to get a little more. And I'll rain into it, and I'm going to shade the front darker. second as I'm moving it down. Bring this little boat down. I need to have the lower part of the boat. I think I'm going to need more shadow here. But that's okay. I can always add. It's hard for me to take away. That's why you guys have to. So we've got those two values. I'm going to come with a little of my yellow and my black, which is like a sort of green in this world. Let's see that. I'm shading this right here from the water's edge of the boat. So I need this darkest sort of shadow that happens there. I'm going to come underneath. Hopefully I can do this with this brush. It's sharp enough. Shadow under here. I'm going to pull some of that shadow down. Okay. Glaze. Get the smidgiest burnt umber, phthalo green ever. Maybe even some zinc. And I'm gonna pop little weird bits of bright paint on the boat. It's gonna be about restraint here. Maybe a little more yellow ochre. Right here. Under the bow. Trying to get this kind of worked out. Now, under my boat. I'm going to get my black. I'm going to come along this front lip. Under this boat. Now I'm here with my pure black. It is not something I'm using around the canvas. It's something I'm only going to use here. And I'm going to flip and work out my boat now. I'll also flip my reference so I don't get lost in it.
That's a good point.
Huh?
I hadn't even thought about that.
Yeah.
You have to flip your reference image so you don't confuse yourself.
Yeah, I will. I don't know about everybody else, but I for sure will confuse the heck myself and not catch the things that I need to catch. Right? The weird stuff. Oh, this is really weird.
What's weird?
I think it's obviously a Photoshop mistake. Right? Because it's still the both are not the same.
There you go.
But mine probably know what was happening there, but you wouldn't have different flaking on this reflection than you had on the top reflection. It just wouldn't be something that you had. So first, you want to make sure this boat looks nice. I'm going to get a little of my yellow ochre just on my dirty brush with some white. And I'm going to come along the top here and add my highlight to the boat. My highlight isn't white. It is up top. My line is a bit up top. Let's my brush out and get a little more yellow ochre. And yellow. Off the boat. And I'm going to work my zinc now because it needs to be lighter but not as light. I'm going to just start to create a reflection. a darker version of what we have here, and maybe not all of the information will be there. It's tidily. Wipe off the brush. Give this a shadow underneath. Now we're
going to
have a second shadow.
Oh, this is a good question. Luis was asking, is the shadow under a boat, under the boat a living shadow?
Normally, if we were landscape painting, it would be, but what we have here is so deep that we're not doing a living shadow. But it's the sense it almost is, because reflection is where our shadow has its life, which landscape takes its form. Does that make sense? Going to get my green, yellow, and my black. And remember that makes a gray, which is a green.
And I'm really loving how this is coming together.
I'm so glad.
Yeah, we've had 500 people here pretty much the entire time and really enjoying this landscape. So thank you for doing this. They all really love you to say thanks. Thank you.
Yes,
really love that. Great. Really great.
I think so too. I think it's going to be really stunning when we get the front grasses on. So I'm doing the same shading, but I'm just making muted colors. And I will go ahead and get a little of the yellow green on my brush. Pop some where I had reflections down here. Some of that paint event.
Now, a living shadow, just to sort of recap, is when you use.
You don't really use. Perfect.
Go ahead.
No,
I was just wanting to make sure I'm trying to lead the questions.
So when you're outside landscape painting, you are actually painting reflective light. So you won't see black very often in nature. Or anything that really even feels black, so you're really working chromatics. Let's see how this looks. We need to evaluate. How is it looking? Oh, wonderful. So the shadow is darker. We've actually given ourselves the same dark but really has a bunch of white stuff in it, so
yeah.
Weird that. And now we need to make our reflection. I'm gonna get on our cable, I'm gonna use my sink. To do this cable.
So your living shadows would be done with more color rather than blacks.
Yeah, you would have like reflections that came up into them. All kinds of things.
And you're focused on what you're doing, so.
I'm taking my zinc here and I'm going to kind of break up. If you'll notice, I'm putting my hand biting into this.
Oh.
A slight ripple.
Just sort of makes that look.
Sets it out a little bit. I want it out. Because a little bit of pigment went where I didn't want it to go. So the best solution to that is to make my background color again, which we know is a smidge of blue into my black and a whole lot of white. So we get back to the value that is the background color. And you can come. So too dark. Wipe off. A lot more white. You just wanna make sure that purple part isn't too broad.
Mm.
And the cables have a nice marriage into the water. Okay, yeah, so the best example that we have right now of living shadows is probably the other boat I did because the sand, and oh, we're going to have it on the girls walking on the beach. It was going to be so expressionistic. All right, so how's that going? Let's see. Liking it. Liking it a lot. I just like to break that. Break it. Okay. Now we're going to sit up to see. and mentally prepare yourself. So you can see the boat actually starting to make this painting come to life. But what we've got to do is nail our graph here and our graph here. No pressure, guys. I might need another sip. Number four, cat's tongue out.
Yep.
And then we'll start my work. So my first work is going to be my ultramarine blue and my burnt umber, maybe even a little black. I'm going to start putting it in the world. You know, actually, hold on a second, guys. Where's your brush? Get some glaze. You're going to need to glaze shadows right here in the corner. There's a little one right here. We're going to need to glaze those shadows. Then I might put some of my background color back in here. Really, maybe very important to have that happening right around here. Otherwise, it's just going to be like, wait, what? Back to dark color. Back to dark color. Back to dark color. This is going to be just about creating these light lines in the detail. It is like first thought. If you can't, one of the things that can be unpleasant to try to take water from your water cup to your palette to your brush. These misters let you do that in a very controlled way. So they're also super lovely. And that will improve the flow and the fineness of the lines that you're getting. You're going to want fine, fine little lines. These first waves are warm shadows. We're not going to worry about catching the ones that have colors. One minute. I'm going to want to put some reflections of your graph. So, this trick about reflections, if your graph bends this way, your reflection bends the opposite way. It's always making lesser than or greater than simple. If you're looking, you might not have noticed. What kind of words are true? I'm just doing little foot strokes. My brush is doing work for me. Using these little bits. I might have like lots of little strokes here. Talk about a little pump of cluster of grass there. There. And it certainly can start happening out here. All around the soft edge, which we've already put in. Right? We've already softened at the base of that edge with our sand brush. I'm going to soften it more with these little bunches of lines that are happening.
You know, wanted me to make sure I passed them on. Thank you for taking all the time to do this very detailed painting.
Oh, yes, it was fabulous. It's so good. I so appreciate your patience, you guys, too, for doing these more detailed paintings. Because if we do this, then it may go well, then we don't do the fast forward, and you guys can see the whole process. And I like that.
Thank you for being tolerant of our technical glitches as well.
Yes. Because of everything. I'm just adding all my little blades of grass. Trying to talk about those little blades of grass. talk about them one way. We can also talk about them the other way. A little bit.
In the upside down.
In the upside down. This is about seven strange within the paintings. And, you know, like I said, there was that great club. I just didn't. It's one of those rare times. It's very rare that I have a property that I don't have something that I come artistically to do with it. But that was one where I had a huge amount of passion and didn't have anything artistically to say about it, which is really weird.
They said a lot. This is visually enjoyable to watch.
Oh, it's just the best. And then I looked at everybody had that, and I thought, oh, it's so weird. I didn't even put that. So I'm just filling up the layers.
There's been some great performance art on YouTube about it.
Yeah, I think so. I'm going to go back to my glaze, and I'm going to get my color on here. And certainly right here, I'm going to start pulling this down. I know I'm going to be doing quite a bunch of that. Little reflection back here. Loading up the glaze. Glaze never hurt nobody. Well, maybe it did, but. Oh, maybe it didn't hurt again. I'm just making sure some of this is. Now, if you ever take out too much of your sky reflection, you just come back and just put all the way back in, right? Couple places. Don't be stressed about it. Take this back. And I think I'll quite dark all the way right here. This will actually even have to get darker. But we've got so much grass to do. All right. Let's take our Indian yellow and our ultramarine and start making our little grass colors. Start pulling them up. Get that one yellow. Put a number in that. Pull them up. And then a little layer of color. I know. It's a long day. There we go. More brown right here. Just thinking about it. Maybe tape this up.
There you go.
There you go. I'm going to grab some just brown.
Now, there's a couple questions here.
I can answer lots of questions because we'll be grassing for.
So, I'm going to work through these somewhat backwards. Is there
a current number? Just bring this detail here. I'm going to so much to build up.
Debbie would like to know, is there anything other than a glazing liquid that will retard the drying of paint?
Well, glazing liquid in general doesn't retard the drying of paint, only golden glazing liquid. So, like, straight up at this moment in time when this video is made, I have no relationship with golden other than I'm familiar with their products and they answer long, involved technical questions. with a tremendous amount of patience.
And they're very friendly.
And they're very friendly. I like them, and I've been with them, and I do know. But there's not a financial remuneration at this time, right? So I chose Golden Glazing Liquid because until that point, I had a retarder I really liked and a glaze I really liked. Glazes dry fast. Retarders dry slow. You can't put a tint in a glaze, I mean a retarder, because it'll never dry. Golden had this product, which was both. I was like, you can glaze with this, and it slows the drying time down on my paint, and it doesn't get gummy. I love it. Other than this, as a retarder, I really like Chrome Blocker's retarder. But it's a retarder, so you cannot tint with it. You have the exact mixture, formulation, of retarder to paint that you can use.
Okay, so second question. If you're using a gloss medium,
mm-hmm.
and you thin it out with water, will some areas be more glossy than others once it finally dries?
Well, so some things that can impact that, yes, that can happen. And some things that can impact that are the shadows here on my glasses. Sure, it's all authentic. So what can happen is that your paints can have different matte finishes, your paint can have different finishes. Your water can impact the finish. I don't think there's anything else, but I could be wrong, that impacts your finish.
If you unify that finish, what should you do?
Varnish. That's the whole reason there's varnish. So, like, some people really prefer a matte. I'm just creating the shadows here in my water. So I want my grass to be... out. I'm just making sure. Sorry, sometimes it gets as painting as the thinking and the painting don't go together at all. It's a little, it's a struggle that I have. So all your paint products have finishes to them. It'll generally tell you what the tube of paint. Is it glossy? Is it transparent? Is it matte? Is it semi-matte? And then among the painting, you're using a lot of different products. It can have like several different finishes. John circles through this during the photography session on my artwork. Because if some of it's shiny and some of it's matte, boy, you can't get a good color.
Oh, it's hard to get good color balance and light balance. Because literally one color is reflecting more than the other one.
So I'm just trying to do this to make sure that I have some defined reflections. I'm putting the grass. I'm going to keep putting the grass, but I just need to find some reflections. If that makes sense. So I'm going to use the vanilla and the phthalo green and a little black. A little bit. I'm going to keep building up this detail. Grass. Even yellow. Also learning. Better. The only place I really like the thing is a little bit there, a little bit there. Just too saturated. What did I put on the box? Just making sure that my grass exists in the water. I have a lot to do here in the front of the grasses.
Which brush did you pick up there?
I've got the number 4 cast from this because it's doing a detail round too. It would be also awesome. Over here, towards the right of the canvas, my grasses are browner and more yellow. I'll definitely have to be working that out. I'm trying to change my brush direction as I'm painting. Over all that. And some blue. I'm just trying to make sure.
Meg Reddy was asking if you wanted to have the certain areas of the painting be reflective or glossy, like say the water, could you just paint that area glossy?
Yes, you could, but it won't help you the way you think it will. But yes, you can. You can do that. I'll see artists try to do that. They'll be like, they'll paint something shiny because they're trying to paint a shiny, glossy surface, but it doesn't carry the way that they think it will.
So something you have to experiment with?
Yeah. Yeah. It may not give you the reflective surface you're thinking of. I just added some thick white. I'm adding some lighter colored grasses here. I'm going to come here and just also adding some just little bits of detail of could be little grassy bits right here. Just got some, I want it to be darker than that. So I went right into my ultramarine blue, which does that. Softening this edge, showing grass off the bank as well. Trying to blend the areas that my sand worked with where my brush was working. I'm going to take a little of my ultramarine and my black. I'm going to come here. I'm going to deepen. So there's a lot of my canvas going through right here. It's playing against me. And in a minute, I'm going to have to create some depot grasses that play with these other grasses that I have created here. Everything okay? I hear you moving around. So I'm just trying to make sure this is building up detail. The trick is going to be, guys, is that you don't want this to get muddy, but we have to keep it muted. And how can we stop it from getting muddy and keeping it muted? Now, I'm going to switch into the much smaller brush, so I'm going to let John get back. And that way you can follow what I'm mixing. I'm going to make some highlights and some low lights. I'm going to get into my detail brush, and I'm going to create some areas of detail that are going to make the whole piece feel more detailed. So it's not about creating every detail necessarily, but it's about picking the right details and putting them in the detail. Alright. So I have here a number one. And I'm going to get my ultramarine and my burnt umber. I'm going to make that, remember that third grade grass color that we have. I'm going to use the floor brush. Create some little stories of grass. Maybe even a little more putty, a little more rustic brown. Just pulling some of these grayed out bits in here. Just grab some lighter color. Maybe I'm gonna take a little bent over grass and come in with this brush and start detailing out some of my grass lines. Okay, he's got the other one. We're just detailing out some of our grass lines.
I'm still here with you.
The ultramarine.
Huh? I'm still here with you.
Are you? Okay. So we can go through and be like, oh, that's so
cool. If I had a magic switcher.
Alright, I'm gonna miss this a bit. Miss this a bit. I'm gonna dark colors, but about each of these little grass lines. Some of them are going to come off the canvas now. I'm going to actually turn the canvas upside down to help me. If I don't pull some of these little blades of grass off, let me get a little zinc. If I don't have them coming in from over here, that happening? Needs to feel like not only is it reflecting, but that it's coming from before we're on the canvas to after. These elements being closest to us, the darkest in detail. So we're just kind of putting them in a more thoughtful. I'm just making sure that these lines are maybe thought about a little bit. Okay, the fork that's over here.
Where's that?
Which is going to be mostly our need some highlights in here. Just working it out. So I feel like this is too messy right here. Brush. Think about how all of this is coming in and there's more detail in the rest of the canvas. And while I'm here, I'm going to mix the background color and I'm going to fix this right here because I hate it.
What's this?
This grass area. Don't like it. Right here.
Wow. Alright.
So I'm going to take a little of my blue. I know you guys are tired, but.
Oh, no, no, they're. Look, they just let you know. Yeah, guys, she doesn't get to have a chat because if she does have chat,
then she'll work.
But
look, I don't care if you're a teacher on a live show or you're painting at home, it is okay as long as your paint's dry to change anything that you are not loving. And I'm not loving. So I'm fixing it.
That's what you're doing.
You're not loving it. Fix it. Because it doesn't look right. It's not going to look right until you make it look right. Now my big thing here is I'm going to lighten this enough. Then I go in very carefully and try again. And sometimes you have to go in very carefully and try again. Now, some of my fix here is because I'm painting the quality paint that I'm painting. I mean, here's the hair dryer, and one more coat, and it's going to be gone.
Okay. Thank you guys for hanging out with us today. I'm looking forward to seeing all the landscape paintings for you guys, the boats. This has been like, you know, in that more complex level of painting that we've done. So thank you guys for coming and hanging out and painting along with us here.
You know, it's
always nice to see you guys. Especially since it's a long painting.
No, it's fine.
We're really good. Like I said, we've had 500 people pretty much the entire time. So they're really enjoying doing this.
Once you have that back out, you can come back and we'll put some stuff back in. I just was not loving it, and so I'm not keeping it.
And because folks really like seeing you fix these kinds of things, because that lets them know how they can just do it themselves.
Yeah, and it's super important to know how to do that yourself. All the stuff I want and need. Just adding some more details in the dark. Sometimes on a painting, it's really just about recognizing where you sped too fast, slowed down, and thought about your process, and you're being in messy boots.
I like that. The water in front of there just looks nice.
Hopefully, let's see if we can get it.
I like it.
There to hopefully help us out.
Yeah, DH says that truly appreciates you seeing you do the repair, you know, the change, because, you know, then they know what they might want to do.
Well, something like this, you know, where we have this lovely grass. And we're trying to, you know, talk about this other grass. We don't want to do all that hard work and then get the result that we're going. So instead it would be better, I think, to do less here.
Just some emotional grass.
Just some like we did up there. Coming home from here, not as much as there is. I'm doing very fine. I'm just trying to make the reflection. Saying, now it's better.
Yeah. I like
that. So again, remember it's a mirror. So where you're putting these little bits of grass out. So everyone that you do, you're already going to take it down.
George agreed. He's like, yeah, I like the water in the front.
Just a little bit open. That'd be perfect. And it also gives us a path for the painting on visual envelope. So the trick would be putting in the right amount of grass here.
So I remember someone was asking earlier in the show if this is your first time painting.
This is why sometimes our rehearsal pieces are, but right now we're working and getting ready for stand-ups looking. I like that.
I like it too. Oh, that's really nice.
So then what we want to do is just have a lighter bit of grass there. I might come back through and add a little highlight white to some of the space. Even enforce that a little more. But I think it's pretty happy. Reflective ripples on this bank of grass. So that can help us there. So getting those reflective ripples. I felt I'm good.
Yeah, I like it.
Sure, put up the baby landscape today.
I'll be in there.
Well, I mean, I can say it, but I don't have enough moisture on campus to do it. I'm going to sign over here indiscreetly. So that's painting, but not disruptive. It's painting. Let's look at it. Okay. So we get there.
Yeah.
So is this really that last part for me? Is that happened visually just got overwhelming in my brain and I started painting representationally instead of objectively.
Yeah.
So what happens to my, you know, like sometimes your right brain will check out, your left brain will come in and goes, grass, grass, and then your right brain's like, yeah, that doesn't look right, but I'm not weighing in. So sometimes it's good to take a step back, walk away from a piece and come back to it. If you're not able to walk away from a piece, like I'm not able, like normally I would take this piece over several days. I would look at it and walk away, I digest it, I look at it and walk away, I digest it. But if you're not able to, sometimes you have to simplify. And so how you fix that part is we just open it up and said, let's grab would be really helpful now.
Let's get a zoom in on that real quick.
Okay.
You know, oh, you're going to come over there and hold it, tilt it out for me. Tilt the tracks out for me. Oh, yeah. Make it work. Oh, is that? See, that turned out really good. Just a stunning thing.
Oh, thank you. Hopefully it gives you hope for tomorrow's painting, which I'm really excited to do. So many trees, and I love the colors. I'm just excited about the colors of painting. I'm excited about the process of that painting.
Hope.
So hopefully everyone will be able to come tomorrow, too. Just do these birch trees. Awesome.
Yes.
It's a pretty much run out of things to call birch trees over the season. Because I paint them a lot, it comes back winter, and so, and then everyone else paints them a lot, come fall, winter, and then you're just trying not to find the exact same thing everybody else called theirs. And so, like, they're really thin on the ground. We're going to have to start calling them shanty birches.
More birch.
More birch.
Birch three.
More birch. All the birches. Birches until you're burst out. I think once I just was like, I think the Southwest week I was like, aspen trees.
Yeah.
Ah! It's another tree that's broken right. So, that's the word tangential thing, but you guys have been with me for a minute. Any questions before we sign out?
Let me go over here.
I didn't think about it.
No, I think most everybody was just right now saying thank you because they know we're coming to the end of the show. So most everyone's just saying thank you. They really appreciate this. April just says, love doing the landscape, really appreciates it. Goldie has been saying thank you, thank you, thank you. Wanted me to remind you through this whole time. Lori and Vinquita and Julie and Neva, they are all saying thank you and they loved it. And they missed the dancing. Next time we got to do some more dancing.
Can I turn the music back? It is hard to be a bit Arabic. It is the music. Good to yourself, be good to each other. I'm going to see you at the Gorilla Center.